So now we've been in California 2 weeks and we've managed to visit 4 different states up the Pacific Northwest coast all the way up to Seattle. We've been into Nevada, California, Washington State, and Oregon State. And the weirdest thing we found out about every single one of these places is as soon as you cross a state line, everything becomes different. So now we're finishing our trip in San Francisco, backdropped behind me, and we're gonna go and visit some medical facilities now. We've done the growers, we've done the community, we've done Seattle Hemp Fest. Now it's to get down to the nitty gritty of the medical aspect of the plant. So over in the far background in the bay is Alcatraz. It probably needs no description. It is one of the most hideous places on earth to put people in cages into. Gives me the shudders thinking about it. And over my right shoulder over here in the mist is the iconic Golden Gate Bridge. So with all of these hippie visits and just the general vista and everything, it's a really cool place to visit. It's very much the most expensive city we've visited in recent memory. We have an Airbnb way down there somewhere. The steepest street in a metropolitan area in the world is just over here as well. It's got a 17 degree slope. We did that the other day in a cable car with some crazy mechanisms and people with brakes at the back and levers at the front. And it was one of those touristy idyllic things that you have to do when you're in the area. We also ate some incredible seafood down in the docks and were subjected to the most incredible sunset as well. That was a really beautiful moment. We had dinner with Donald Abrahams, who, as you may remember, was one of our expert witnesses for the trial of the plant. It was really good to meet him on his home turf. And the highlight and one of the main reasons we came to San Francisco was to check out the Harborside Dispensary and catch up with legendary cannabis activist Steve DeAngelo on his home turf.
What's happened in 2019 is that I'm getting to travel around the world a lot more. So I've been going to places. I got to go to Colombia. I spoke at two back-to-back conferences in Colombia. And then this really incredible thing happened to me there, because there were people from all over the world at these conferences. Right? There were people from India, there were people from Israel, there were people from Canada, there were people from every single country in Latin America, without exception. Right? And within the first day or two of the first conference, the people who like really love cannabis, who have a real strong connection to the plant, we all found each other, right? And it wasn't hard. We found each other really quickly. And as soon as we found each other, it was like this seamless fit. And we hung out together for a few days. By the end of a few days together, it felt like we had been together for our whole lives. So just in thinking about this, it's like we came together remarkably easily. We came from all these very different backgrounds. Some people were investors, and some people were entrepreneurs, and some people were, you know, that came from families of wealth, and some people came from very humble backgrounds. Yeah. We all fit together, and it was because we all shared the same set of experiences with cannabis. Right? We had all had the same experiences. We had suffered the same kind of oppressions. We had been through the same kind of struggles. And so I started thinking about this and realized that now that we're beginning to bring down the walls of prohibition, yeah, it's kind of like we've all been in these little caves where we've all had to huddle during these years of prohibition, right, for our own safety. Mm-hmm. And we're getting that now, enough now that we're in many places around the world coming out of the caves and we're like, hey, look, you look kind of like me. No, wait, you look really like me. So now I'm really into this concept of the tribe, the one tribe, the cannabis tribe, the worldwide cannabis tribe. Because if we do some simple things as a self-conscious group of people with shared values, think what we could do, right? If everybody who loves and cares about this plant around the world replaced one half of their wardrobe with hemp, we would be a multi-billion-dollar hemp fashion industry. Overnight, we would save millions of gallons of water and untold amounts of pesticides from being put on the planet. If everybody that loves this planet stopped eating beef or ate half as much beef as they normally do, right? How many acres of the Amazon could we save as a tribe? Right? So we can do these very powerful, simple things that no government needs to empower us to do. We don't have to raise money to do them. All we have to do is act as a group, as a tribe, on the basis of the values that we all share already.
Do you think Canada's trying to destroy that kind of culture, the way that they've set things up? It does look as if the old school cannabis community, the growers, the old trades, the people who took the risks and got the ball rolling, they've been sidelined throughout the whole event. There's no mention of human rights in any legalization model in Canada. What's your views on the Canadian model?
Well, look, what you see happening in Canada is a worldwide pattern. I see it everywhere. I saw it in Colombia too, right?
Yes, indeed.
There are three worlds of cannabis today, right? There's the legacy cannabis world. The people who cared enough about this plant to carry it through the years of prohibition.
We just learned that word and we love it.
It's our latest word in our vocabulary. We kind of call it craft cannabis, but legacy is a great word.
Legacy, right? Then there's this new thing. Corporate cannabis, right? And we can't stop it. It's here. It's part of legalizing cannabis. So how do we deal with it, right? And that's where the third world of cannabis comes in, and that's the world of conscious cannabis, okay? The world of people who have a connection to this plant. Some of those people are going to build companies, and all of those people are going to consume cannabis. And together, we are a tribe who has shared values, right? And we can decide who to empower in this industry and who not to. We talk about it, if we think about it, if we act as a group, act as a tribe, we can decide which of these companies thrive and which don't.
I want to get back to the last prisoner project. I think I read, correct me if I'm wrong, that you have either floated Harborside on the stock exchange or you have a plan to.
Yes.
And am I right in saying that that is to attract investment so you can turn it into the project? Is that the way you're trying to get the suits?
There's only one way to get the suits, man, and that's with money.
Right.
Okay? Yeah. So the reason that Harborside went public on the Canadian Securities Exchange is because if you want to be a competitive cannabis company in California today, you only have one choice, which is to scale up, right?
Yeah.
You either scale up or you get eaten. And so we went to Canadian Securities Exchange, because if you want growth capital, that's where you need to go to get it. If you go across that bridge there, you'll see a billboard from one of my competitors who shall remain nameless. If you go down that direction, you'll find another billboard. If you go back that direction, you'll find another one, right? So really just to stay competitive, right? But contemporaneously with the company going public on the Canadian Securities Exchange, I and my brother and some other wonderful people launched the Last Prisoner Project, which is a nonprofit organization dedicated to one simple goal, and that's releasing every single cannabis prisoner wherever they are in the world. And we're not going to stop until we do that. So we talk about retirement. I've already made a pledge. I will not stop and I will not rest until our last prisoner comes home. And we have, in this country alone, we have 40,000 plus people who are still in prison on cannabis charges, some of them for life. Right, yeah, about 20 people who are here. They will die in prison if we don't get them out.
So how can we become part of this project in Southern Africa? What can South Africans do to speed things along in our region?
Well, I would say that the first thing to do would be to find some, you know, very highly motivated, passionate young lawyers.
We have those already. Our legal team are amazing. We're all under the age of 40.
And then we will put them in touch with the really amazing staff at the Last Prisoner Project, Sarah Gersten, who's a Harvard law grad, and Mary Bailey, who's one of the best project managers that I've ever met in my life. And they could start talking about learning from each other, right? Right now, we are just, we're not even launched yet, right?
We'll launch
in September.
Yeah.
And we will be focused initially on the U.S. and Canada. Mm-hmm. But we're already, as soon as we started talking about this online, we've got people from all over the world who have been responding. So it's clearly there is a energy worldwide to make this happen. You're in a situation where cannabis isn't legal yet. So it's very difficult to get people released from prison for a crime that's still a crime.
I understand.
And here we have a situation where we've got people who are in prison for something that's no longer a crime. So the first thing you do is just make it legal so it's not a crime anymore.
Yeah.
And then you can really start focusing on getting people out. In the meantime, right, I think that the prisoner support is really important and telling the stories. So one of the things I discovered after I started doing this, we started talking to released prisoners, and there's one story that's up, you can check it out, this amazing woman, Evelyn LaChapelle. But as we have collected and told the stories of released prisoners and what happened to them, people are responding in a really, really heartfelt way. And so I think just if all you were able to do was sit down with a dozen different people who had been arrested and served time in South African prisons on cannabis charges and told their story. So I think the stories are really powerful. Just like the stories of patients, right? There's nothing quite as powerful as a patient telling their story. Same thing, because you know, there's this impression in people who aren't connected to the cannabis community, the people who are doing time on cannabis charges are these horrible people, or they were making tons of money, and it's not true. That's not who I think. People who make tons of money don't end up in prison.
No, not in the United States, not in South Africa, not anywhere.
Well, I would love to come.
We'd love to pick you up at the airport. We're gonna go home and put the kettle on.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, I'm planning out 2020 now. Tentatively, an Asian leg in February, March.
Okay. We could.
When is a good time?
The middle of winter. It's different time. It's around the country. We'll take you where the weather suits your clothes. Okay. We'll take you wherever the weather suits your clothes.
During harvest time, the indicas are harvested around March, April, and then the large African sativas go into May and June because they have a very long growing cycle. So any time, we would say from the beginning of March to the middle of July.
Well, it's the African sativas that are going to. I'm also really interested. Most spiritual traditions that have incorporated cannabis also have origin stories about the plant.
So I want
to collect origin stories
about
the cannabis plant.
Yeah.
So anybody that could tell those stories to somebody.
The more time you give us, the more we can plan stuff, because I think you could fill quite a few auditoriums in South Africa. You are very well known there.
Okay.
You really are. I mean, you're one of the most well-known people in the world of cannabis. And I would like to shake your hand, because you really are the man. And the closing speech you gave at Oxford, this house would legalize cannabis, that's one of the coolest speeches in cannabis that I've ever heard.
You look like you're having a good time.
It just came from here, dude. It puts a tear in our eyes every time we watch that one. That's a cool speech.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you so much for talking to us, Steve. Excellent, man.
Thank you, Steve.